And then tonight, again, our dear friends are here, Gord and Jan Whyte, and we love them very, very much. And they have been a blessing to us in a lot of ways. Some you know about because it's happened here. There are other times when they'll just call or text and have a prophetic word for Cheryl or I or the church. And so we're very thankful for that. But even as great as that is, what we really love is their friendship. They've been wonderful friends to us. So let's welcome Gord and Jan Whyte.
Wow, okay. Jan was determined to come to this weekend, so I just need a chair. Oh, there we go. Do you have a music stand handy that I can put on for Jan a little? Can you see that? We're good. We're good. Anyway, just real quick, for some, I think most of you guys, well, how many people were here 5 years ago when I was here? Four. No. Anyway, hey, it's good to be here, and I've seen changes. You got three nice little TVs now, and that's good. So Jan wants to kind of just share some things. It's an interesting week before we came, praying for, you know, God, what should we do when we arrive down here? What do we have to say? So there's some things been bubbling, and so it could be all over the place. I hope not, but we will land the plane eventually. So again, this is Jan, and she has some things she wants to share. And yeah, just okay. Yeah, okay, good. She wants me just to sit right down here.
Just in case.
One of those guard dogs.
Do you know what? Okay, it's my turn.
Okay.
Gonna
give him a heads up.
Okay. No, don't. Let's surprise him. Where's the TV camera that goes all over the world? Where is that? Straight up? This is my good side. This is incredible. I walked in the front door and I was smoked by the Spirit of God. Whoa, you guys. Whoa. Whoa. I have this little widow's mite thing to just say to you, and I'm taking home so much more. That's why I'm here. I said to Gord, I gotta go. I gotta get stuff. I'm bringing back stuff that you have. It's so, you guys, this is so awesome. What I want to say to you, the word I have for you is never give up. Never, never give up. Whoa, never, never. You are so very close, so very close. Oh my goodness, oh my goodness. I love this church. I love Dave and Cheryl, wherever they are. Where's Dave? Where is he? Oh, there you are. He's so cute. Kind of a cowboy. And the team, man, and these kids, whatever, this worship team, whoa, blew my socks off. That is... You know, where we are, and hopefully none of them are watching because they're all old. They're all old fogies. So this is just a breath of fresh air. Woohoo. I am blown away by the hand of God on this place. I'm blown away by the way you are prepping for these prophesied times. You know, we all know what's coming. And the provision that he has given you with that, what, just watching that, wow. Wow, his hand, it's like his hand, okay, he's just going GT, yeah, right. Wow, you're doing so well. I don't even know how to work this, Gord. How do I make the lines go up? the things go up. Can you just stand here and do this? I'm right here.
We've been married for 53 years, I get it.
I'm done. Okay. All right. Okay. Sorry about having to do this. My notes are at home. All the things I had, and so is my Bible, and I had to borrow one from the lady that we're staying at. She was so gracious. I feel, you know what it's like when you forget your Bible? Man, it's bad. It's bad. And pardon me, I am like quite done in the spirit because of you guys and lunch and all that kind of stuff, and so I really want this to be really good. So really, I'm trying my best. So I want to encourage you in another kind of prepping, also prophesied. Okay, folks, the fields are white unto harvest, and he needs all hands on deck. That's what I wanted to talk about, all hands on deck for the coming harvest. Whoa, whoa, I see them coming. I see them coming. I see dust arising from their feet. That's what I see. That's what I see. Oh, they're hungry, and they are racing towards sanctuary cities. That's coming, they're coming, they're coming, they're coming. And it's time for the army of God, which is right here, the army of God, to get into rank and file as one mighty army. One mighty army. Interject Ezekiel, it says. I'm supposed to read about the bones coming together, clang and clang and all that. Where's the Bible?
It's in my bag.
Okay, does somebody just want to read that about them and read it good and strong? Well, about a mighty army is rising with real authority, because it's just, boy, you're letting me down.
Here we go.
You going to read it? Okay, thank you.
Oh, you got the word.
Okay, what translation? Oh, it's mine.
This is yours.
Okay. Can you see it?
837, here.
Okay. 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 The hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones, and he led me back and forth among them. And I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, "Son of man, can these bones live?" I said, "O sovereign God, you alone know." And then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you." We sang that. Did you notice that? Mm-hmm. "I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. Oh, wow. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin, and I will put breath on you, and you will come to life, and then you know that I am the Lord." Whoa. So I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them. But there was no breath in them. And then he said to me, "Prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Come from the four winds of breath and breathe into these slain that they may live." So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them, and they came to life and stood up on their feet, a vast army. Stand up on your
your feet. Stand up on your feet. Woo! Yes. Yes. Whoa. So the warriors, the healers, the servers, the deliverers, the prophets, the fathers, the worshipers, the administrators, the helpers, the workers, the teachers, better get ready. Whoa, because they are coming and they are running, and they are your sons and daughters, your brothers and sisters, and your aunts and uncles, and your mom and dad, and your nana and papa, and the orphans, and the sexually broken, the disenfranchised, the prisoners, and the orphans, they're all coming. He is here waiting for them with a ring and a robe. So, scripture tells us that we overcome him, the mean, nasty, crummy, rotten devil, by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. And I want to testify to something. Oh, and then it says they did not love their lives too much as to shrink from death. And Pastor Dave told me something, because I was so nervous, and he told me a story about his father. Can you just tell that, yell it out, that story about your dad?
Yeah. First time I preached at my dad's church.
Yeah. All right. First time I preached at my dad's church, I was in an office right off to the side. I was nervous. I was in Bible college, and he came back during worship, and he said, "You look nervous." I said, "I am, little." He said, "Why?" I said, "Because I'm about to preach for my first time in your church." And he said, "Well, son, it's not about you."
Amen.
And I said, "It's not?" He said, "No, it's not about you. It's about how much God loves his people."
Yes.
"And he's going to bless his people. Yeah. All you have to do is make sure you don't screw things up."
That was so encouraging to me. So, as a way of testimony, I want to share a testimony of deliverance that is very fresh, very close to my heart, full of miracles, God speaking, and folks just like you sharing their love, prayers, and gifts with a 70-year-old man very near death. The man was my brother, is my brother. 55 years, a drug and alcohol addict. 55 years, 55 years. 40 ounces of rum a day, I think that's a whole heck of a lot. Plus marijuana, which was a big deal then. It's not in Canada, it's legal, if you can believe it. And that other stuff, cocaine, he was on, so he was like a zombie. Skin and bone, out of food and money. His mind was totally blown. And God chose to look down on him.
In Mexico.
It's not Mexico yet. Okay. In his desperate need. And you know what he said? He said to him, he spoke to him audibly, to this drug addict on the floor, just going, "I help." And God said, "Son, I hear you." He said it. "Now get on your knees and I will listen." That dialogue, the dialogue that followed, he doesn't even remember. But this thing he does, 4 months he battled that, whatever that's called, detoxing thing. And he said he was never alone. God was with him. Awesome. The whole time.
speaking words of kindness and love, if his body endured this horrible, it's horrible to get off stuff like that. 55 years. No. 4 months into his withdrawal, he connected with us via Facebook. He had begun to come out of the fog. I had not heard from him for 25 years. I thought maybe he would come home in a jar of, you know, ashes or something. We didn't know where he was. We knew nothing about him. Now, Pastor Dave said I could say this. You know what I'm going to say? His last words to me 25 years ago were, F your faith, F your family, F your prayers, F your very existence. You're dead to me now. So I clued in. He didn't want me in his life. So I was shocked to hear from him the following. Jan, I don't know if you even want to hear this, but I have found Jesus, and he's helping me every day. Whoa! He said, I just thought you might want to hear that. Well, hello. So we were very, we were cautiously optimistic because we were cautiously optimistic. Graham was a musician. He had been living in Mexico for several years, working in the entertainment industry, until he was no longer able. He couldn't work. He couldn't care for himself. He was skin and bone. He was just an absolute mess. He had no food, no work, no friends, and alienated from his family. Over the next 8 months, Graham and I spoke via text for 5 hours a day. And I began to help him pick up the pieces of his life. It's a big deal. It was not an easy task. And some days I was talking to the lingering demons, and they were not nice to talk to. Mm-hmm. Some days, brain fog, he was like just zombie. Some days, delusional. But always he would send with, but God is real. He's real. And that he just held on. He held on. Finally, I was totally exhausted, but absolutely obsessed with his recovery. And then we felt the Lord speak to us. It takes a village to raise a child. We couldn't do it. We're here. He's in Mexico, thousands of miles away. All we have is, he's got this little phone he's typing on. And anyway, he was out of food, money, and any resources, and he had pawned all his instruments and his stove to pay rent, and he had no one other than us to offer counsel and discipleship. So I looked and I found a food share that was feeding over 900 families in Mexico, in Puerto Vallarta. And I asked if they would mind helping a gringo. And they said, I told them this story, and they said, of course we'll help him. So they arrived. They arrived at his door with all of this food. And he said, Jan, I just fell down, and I just wept at their feet and said, thank you, thank you, thank you. And this old couple said, oh, this isn't from us, this is from God. And he goes, whoa. It just continued. This story just continues. It just continues. Anyway, that doesn't matter. I prayed and I searched the city for English-speaking churches because I knew it was time. He needed to get into a community. It was time. I was directed to this church called Paradise by God, Paradise Church, Puerto Vallarta. Spoke with the lead pastor, who just happened to be a recovered alcoholic and had a huge program for addicts. And he picked him up the next Sunday morning, took him to church, and Graham said, I need to tell you about who I am in my state. And he said, save that for later, Graham. I've talked to your sister. And I understand your situation. Let's get you acquainted with the folks at church. How awesome is it? How awesome is it to be able to say that? You guys can say that. I'd want you to get acquainted with the folks at our church because you're just top-notch, guys. You're top-notch. Anyway, over the next months, this guy loved on Graham, contacted him every single day to see how he was doing, invited him into his home for meals and gatherings with other believers and seekers, filled up his days with Bible studies, work duty, addiction counseling, opportunities to serve the poor. Graham even went to the ladies' Bible study because he had one day with nothing to do. Imagine. He couldn't get enough. It blows my mind. The spiritual growth in this once broken, destitute man has blown me away because of an army of folks whose hearts are prepared and eyes are open to see the awaiting harvest and bring them home. My brother is now healthy, clean, loving Jesus, writing gospel songs, overseeing the feeding program for children with no food, part of the worship team, and preparing to lead the church through the streets on Christmas Eve, singing, praising God with his amazing voice. He told me this would be his best Christmas ever. And you know, those streets are the streets where he was a drug addict. He's known there as a drug addict, and now he's going to be known as a Jesus lover because of people like you. Yes. Whoa. I do believe this will bring comfort to many of you. Some of you here are the Grahams. I know that. Or you're related to them. And I want to say to you again, never, ever give up. Never, ever, ever.
Yeah.
Whoa. Especially now. Whoa. There's nothing too big for our God. Yeah. You are here in this place for a time such as this. A time you can't even imagine. The real deal. The great awakening. The great harvest. That's why we're here. And now, song ready? Because it's time for the lion that is in this church to roar. I want to hear you roar. Whoa!
Yes, God. Yes, God, roar. Yes, God. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Wow. Isn't that an awesome worship song? Well, things have sure changed over the last 5 years since we were here. And I see you've got three small TVs. In Canada, that's small. No, just kidding. And you know, I noticed this little thing here, home groups. And if you're not there, get that way. Do you know the church started with house churches? Don't be surprised if it ends with house churches. So you might as well get used to it now. So I'm sure that many of you in this house have had interesting 3 to 5 years. Ours has been very interesting. Not one of the best 5 years, because we weren't invited here. We've had so much go on in 5 years that I could write a country and western song. You know how it is, the truck died, the dog died, you know, all that stuff. I could do a western song, I'm sure. But it's so good to hear what you guys are doing with the farming and the whole thing. We're a little behind the eight ball. I won't go into the whole deal, but we live in a rural area. We moved out of the big city. We were city slickers, and now we're, well, country bumpkins. Some call us preppers. But anyway, we're a little behind in getting all the stuff done that Dave's talking about. But we have got, we're just blessed to be sitting on 37 acres, and we're doing all the stuff, and eggs and chickens and meat chickens, and got a great big fence going up and a greenhouse and all that stuff. Because in Canada, hamburger that you get in a hamburger is $11 a pound, and our gas is like $8. So I'm not going to go into the whole mess. It's pretty clear. And I really felt like I just want to share some stuff with you. And I mean, it's obvious what's going on, but we're prepared to do it and to go for it. So what we need these days is prayer. We need intercession, fasting. I see you guys are doing that as well. We need to get spiritually sharp. And we need sharp discernment and sharpen our spiritual gifts. When we were singing that, I just saw those swords there, you know, and it's time that we pick them up. And we are entering, not that we haven't, but we need to enter a very extreme season of spiritual warfare. So I just want to say in a nutshell, before I kind of have time now, I don't know how much time do we have? Well, you know what? I'll go as quick as I can. See, in Canada, what Jan and I do, we have church once a month, but it's all day on Saturday from 9 till 5. So we do 4 Sundays in one day. And that's just another whole story that we're doing, which is fantastic, but not time tonight to tell it all. But the scripture that says it all is 2 Chronicles 7:14. And I'll just read it. You all know what it is. If my people who are called by my name humble themselves and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. I mean, yeah, we have government. We have good presidents and we have bad presidents. And we have, in Canada, we have prime ministers, which are good and some are bad. But you know what? For the mess that we're in, man's not going to fix it. It's God. We need to bend the knee. We need to repent. And God will heal the land, because we can't do it. So actually, I think it was this young guy up here, he said, you have to just let go and let God. Well, that's totally, we let go, we let God, but we be wise. And we prepare for the days that are coming. So there's a lot going on. And actually, it's just started. This is just the beginning. And so you need to get ready. But for pastors around the world, it's no longer viable to simply be a keeper of the aquarium. If you know what I'm saying. We need to mobilize the ecclesia. That's you. We need to train them, equip them, and release them. It's like catch and release, like when you're fishing. You catch and release. So even in the midst of the trouble, we don't get so distracted by what's going on that we forget about what? The Great Commission. And the Great Commission was not a subtle suggestion. It was a commandment to do what Jesus died for. And I want to ask you the question without criticizing anybody, but are you ready to do what Jesus died for? And if you're not, you need to get that way. We need to encourage each other, and we need to spur each other on and say, yes, let's do this together. We need to do a 180. Thank you, brother. We need to do a 180 turn. There's a friend of ours in worship leader in Canada, and he wrote a song called Do the 180. So what you do is a line dance sort of thing, and then you do a 180, and you do a turnaround. And that is, it's an amazing song, and that's what we need to do. So we need to see that fivefold ministry released. I want to tell you this, and I'm not suggesting you leave the church, but I want to suggest this. 95% of you have heard so much good teaching here for 35 years that there's not one person in this room that could not establish a church anywhere in the world. You've got the teaching. You just need the anointing to do the teaching. And Jesus loves to give that away. So we're ready, we're equipped. And so I just love to see the ecclesia just going for it. So, you've probably heard this before, but Christianity was never intended to be a cruise ship. Now, I've been on two cruises. Not going again.
I have a little problem with this cow on the water. There we go.
When I get on water, I get sick. It's no fun. Seasick, cruise, no. But on a cruise ship, you know what they've got? 7 or 8 swimming pools. They've got hot tubs. They've got skeet shooting. They've got golf. They've got real trees. They've got casinos. They've got theater. They've got 24/7 food. They have everything. You're so distracted, right? That before you know it, 10 days is just gone. Well, that day's over. And I want to just give you an example. On a personal note, it was several years ago. Our church, I resigned, actually. You never retire when you're in ministry. But I resigned in 2000 because the model, we had a very large church for Canada, about maybe 1,700 people. And it was what you call successful. And we were the watering hole for the Pacific Northwest. We had... Paul Keith Davis is coming here. He's great. We had him a couple times. And we had a visitation by Holy Spirit in 1987, 88. We were Brethren and Baptist background guys. Good guys, but very conservative. Holy Spirit, I'm not going to go into the whole thing, Cheryl, but Holy Spirit invaded us at a Christmas party in our home, and we were never the same. He arrived in our family room at 10 after 10, and he never left until 3 in the morning. It was a shake, rattle, and roll time. And prophecy was birthed, and discernment was birthed, speaking in tongues, interpretation of tongues, visions, on it went. That absolutely changed everything that we did. And for 5 years, we have no scripted Sundays. For 5 years, you show up and whatever is whatever. And we could not stop. In the first year, we grew from 120 of us to about 600 or 700 without doing anything. And that lasted about 5 years. And then there's a bit of a lull. And then we have another visitation in 1994, 95, 96 in there. And so it's wonderful when he comes. So during this time, things were sort of settled down. We got a little complacent. The principality over Canada is complacency, just so you know. And it is strong. And so we, as even a leadership, we got a little complacent. And things weren't working. And I was praying and saying, Lord, things have to change because it's just not the same. And there was reasons for that. And I had this dream, more like a vision, I guess. And I saw our church in the water, but it looked like a Christopher Columbus galley type ship. You know what they look like? Like a pirate ship, sort of, out of the 1850s. And it's listed over like this, almost sinking, full of holes. And we, the leadership, there was about 10 or 12 of us at that time in leadership, running around frantically with a hammer and some sheets of tin trying to fill the holes. And it was not working. And the Lord said, this is your church. I want you to change. And as he said that, another ship came right alongside it, and it was gray, it was sleek, it was modern, it was a battleship. And you could just see it was just made to fight. And then this gangplank came out of the old ship, hooked onto the new ship, and the Lord showed us carrying over items. First item in our hand was a Bible. Then we had worship instruments. He said, take your prayers with you, intercession. Take Holy Spirit gifts. You could see they were just carrying kind of like gifts. And it was a bundle of files, and I said, what's that? And it said it was curriculum and teaching on the kingdom of God. And he said, leave everything else. And I said, but what about all the programs we've got? What about all this stuff we got? And he said, those things are good, but leave it. It's time for a new start. Whoa, powerful. I shared that with our guys and our gals. And to say the short part of it, it was very, very interesting, very difficult. Probably half said, the church is successful. It's not broken. Why would we change it or fix it? And the other half said, well, no, we need to change. And so it was difficult. That's why I finally just, with grace, and we had friendships in place and everything, but we decided we just need to go. And we're just going to try to follow what the Lord showed me in that vision. So what happens when the Lord lifts his hand, because that's actually what happened. We're good people, but we were disobedient. And we went, not we, because Jan and I left, but I was a part of that leadership team and just fighting for change, and I loved everybody on the team. But anyhow, so over the next 14 years, that church now that we co-founded in 1986 has a congregation of 75 people in a building of 60,000 square feet. It was like the frog in the kettle. They didn't leave all at once, but just one and two at a time. So my challenge is that when God speaks, we need to listen. And so now I believe this, and again, I'm going to be all over the place, but I tell you what, we're entering a new era. And your leaders, I know they're sharp people, and they hear God, and they discern, and there's intercession. And there are going to be instructions coming, there's going to be encouragement coming, that some of you may think, gee, like, I don't know, like, this is all so good here, why would we change horses midstream, or why would we, you know, do this or do that? Because I just believe that in this house is coming a huge promotion in spiritual authority. It's coming up. And it is across the board, not only for your leadership team, but for you guys as ecclesia, the body of Christ, the authority that you carry is going to be expanded, all for, not for you, but for the glory of God and for His kingdom. And I'm just going to now tell you some of the things that I felt from the Lord, and I'm just going to give it to you. I believe it's prophetic. I hope if it just rings a bell with one of you, it's worth coming down here. But these are some of the rumblings that are going on in my spirit. Signs and wonders, miracles and healings are going to increase with this new authority that's coming. And it's not going to be a healer in the house. There may be a healer that will lead you, but you get to play. You get to do it. You get to do it. And this, and you watch and see it. And by the way, I feel like the impartation is going to really, you're going to see it in starting in January next year. It's about 3 or 4 months away. Not that it isn't here now, it is, but it's stirring. It's just stirring. It's coming. It's coming. And do you know, these signs and wonders can be pretty crazy. So when it's God, you sort of, you know it's God, but it might be a bit weird. So when your leadership is founded on Christ and founded on Scripture, you're okay. So don't try to push God into a box. You got to let Him out of the box, right? Because you know the God box, which was the Ark of the Covenant, you touched that thing in those days and you're a dead man. But now you carry the kavod, the glory, on your shoulders, just like the priest did in those days. But if you touch the box, you don't die. You touch the box today, you get anointed. And that's what's coming to you guys at GT in a stronger way than you've experienced. Now, it's kind of interesting. I just want to give this as an example. I don't know if it makes sense at all. But Moses, he said, I want to see your glory. And he was desperate. Are you desperate? He says, I want to see your glory. And you know the story. He goes up the mountain with his face unveiled. He comes down the mountain with a veil over his face because his face was shining, freaked everybody out. But I'll tell you a story about that. But also it shows where Moses, again, you know, Moses might be kind of a type and symbol for you guys. I don't know. But what happened, does that ring a bell? Yeah. So Moses, he also was walking along and he looked over and saw this, what says strange sight. You're going to see strange sights. But Moses, he stopped to inquire of the burning bush, and what happened? He received a word from God that released a nation out of captivity. You guys can release individual people from drug addiction, alcohol addiction, sexual addiction. But it takes an anointing. And that's what I believe is coming for you guys. A while ago, I was, quite a while ago now, I was in, where were we, Holland? No, not Holland. Denmark. We're in Denmark. And I was talking about the glory of God. And there was a, and this church was a, you know what a government church is? It's a government church. It's run by the government. They censor everything. You know, if you behave yourself, you can sort of be a pastor. A lot of the pastors there, they're not saved. It's interesting. Anyway, so I'm teaching on the glory. And there's a young guy about 17 years old, and he's at the back of the church leaning up against the wall, and he's shaking. Now, that's weird for this particular church. They didn't know if the kid was having a nervous breakdown or if he was demonized. But it was God. It was God. And so I looked at him because as I was talking, it just struck him. So now he's kind of whimpering and laughing and crying, and he's got his hands out like this, So I said, what's going on? Get up here. So he runs up to me, and he's standing in front of me, tears running down his face. Jan's beside me. He's got his hands cupped like this, and there's this big puddle of oil in his hands. Now, that's strange. Not now, but then it was. Happens all the time. I was in Chicago just prior to the COVID thing, and there was two guys. One was a street preacher, and one was a doctor. And I was just talking about this, and boom, they get hit, and they come up, and both of them got oil dripping off their hands like water. And they said, what do I do? What do I do? I said, get out of the church, get to the street. You got a healing anointing. Those two people had never healed a mouse. They went out there and they started healing people in the streets. I mean, it's just, it happens, you know, it's different. And guess what? I didn't do it. I love to see healings. I preach that a lot around the world, but I don't have to do it. These guys did it. They never did it before in their life because they had the anointing. You can have it. God's not stingy. He gives it to you. It's an issue of the heart. You may not have a seminary anointing or teaching, and that actually could be good news for the days that are coming. Not that that's a bad thing, I'm just saying. That's another topic, isn't it? So anyway, I didn't know what to do. I said, Jesus, what do I do, this kid? He said, anybody that's sick, have them come up and dip their finger in the oil. Don't pray. So I said, oh, I got a translator. So the lineup was, how many, Jan? Many, many. They came up, and they knew it was God, even though it freaked them out. So they came forward. They put their finger in the oil and were slain in the spirit. The church was just laden with bodies all over the thing. And the pastor's going, you know, what? But he knew it was God. It was very powerful. It's hard to explain. So there I am, and I look over at Jan, and there she's standing there, and Jan, sometimes she shakes. That's Holy Spirit. Right now she's limping because she needs a knee replacement. But a lot of the times she's looking for a miracle, and if it doesn't come, well, talk to Drew. He'll let you know how much it hurts. Anyway, Jan's face is shining. And I'm not talking about Mary Kay makeup. Her face is shining. Everybody's freaking out. I'm looking, I'm thinking, my face isn't shining. What's going on? But it was God. Everybody's in shock. We go back to the hotel. Jan's in bed, I'm in bed, and her face is shining. She goes to sleep. I'm sitting there wide awake. I can't sleep. It's like, turn the flashlight off. All night, I'm just staring at her because her face is shining. Next morning, we did a morning service. Place was packed out because they'd heard already that quickly. And all kinds of stuff came, like, so powerfully, you know, gold dust and gold on their faces and gold on their clothes. Some of the ladies went and took showers, and the gold would not come off for 3 days. You know, it was just everywhere, and oil, and it was just signs and wonders. So in this house, you're not going to have to chase signs and wonders. They're going to follow you. So don't get distracted by the signs and the wonders and all the miracles. That's beautiful, but that's part of the package. First, you follow Jesus. You put your eyes on Jesus. You give Jesus all the glory, and it just automatically will follow you, and it'll be so strong you won't know what to do with it. Such a time. Such a time. So in Job 33, he says, For God does speak, first one way and then the other, but men do not perceive it. And I tell you this, you men and women are going to begin to perceive the word of the Lord. Now, there'll always be a prophet or two, but that is an office that's a bit different than the body who can have prophetic revelation. And that's another topic, but God wants to open up your ears and open up your eyes and open up your mouth and to break fear. And if you have a prophetic word and you have fear, break the fear, give the prophetic word, and then the Lord will have grace on you and allow that word to be weighed and tested in the house. And if you missed it, you missed it. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Just say, okay, I missed it. I take that, and then you move on. Good? Good. It keeps the body safe, and it gives you time to practice. So, I'm all over the place, I know. So, you guys got to pray about the Moses thing. I don't get it exactly, but there's something going on there. So there's three things. Now, the body of Christ is made up of many different functions, let's say. Many different anointings, many different ways of giving a blessing and blessing God. And so, Jan and I were talking, I think we left on Wednesday, so probably, or Thursday, we were talking, and I asked Jan to bring a bell. She's got this bell, and I didn't know if we should use it or not. I wasn't sure, but I think I'm going to do that. And when the time is right, I want you to explain the bell. I think when we brought the bell, just yep. In case.
Okay, this bell has been in my family for well over 100 years. It was used in a shop in England, and it was a meat shop. And when it was open, when the meat shop was open in the morning, they would go outside and ring the bell, and it could be heard for many miles to say the shop is open. And there is a scripture. Come on, what's the scripture about? Meat. Come and buy meat.
Yeah.
Yes. What? Bragging about you. All you don't need money, right? Come and buy. And so that's what this bell signifies for the people. To come. They don't need money.
So the butcher shop, when it's open, they ring this bell, and people would run to the shop. And here it is. Isn't that cool? So I think I'm glad we brought this. We'll find out. Sometimes we can just do prophetic acts that don't require much more than that. So I know there's many different groups here, but for me, all that I've heard, and I know that other people will have other things, but I have three groups that I want to call out and bless. And in this house, we have lambs. And the lambs are kind and gentle, compassionate, full of love. They visit the fatherless, the orphan, the widow. They do pure religion. And those are the lambs. The second group are the warriors. And the warriors are the ones that grab those swords over there. They're like the Gideons, like the Samsons, like the Davids. And they walk and they operate in power under Holy Spirit. Now, so do the lambs. So you've got the lambs and you've got the warriors, and you need both. You need both. The third category is watchmen. And in this house, there are watchmen. That is the men and women of Issachar. Those are the ones that stand on the spiritual wall and they see what's coming and they give a warning. And the watchmen are not that popular because we want it easy. We want it quiet. We want it peaceful. But no, we need the watchman. And so I feel like the Lord's asked me to call out the lambs, to call out the warriors, and to call the watchman. Now, to do this, I feel like Dave and Cheryl have to do it. I'm a guest, and I have a different kind of authority in the house than these guys have. They're higher. And so if you wouldn't mind, Dave and Cheryl, to come. And I know that Dave, he represents, right up, he represents the watchman, among other things. Cheryl is the lamb, among other things. And they have pieces of all of that. So I'm going to ring the bell. I want you guys to stand up if you identify. Are you a lamb? Are you a warrior? Or are you a watchman? Now, there's other categories, and it may not be for you tonight. That's okay. You can sit there and don't feel, oh, man, I'm not one of those. That's okay, because there's other things that you can be. But this is what I felt from the Lord just for tonight. So I'm going to ring the bell, and then I want these guys to pray, whatever that looks like.
Okay, so I want Cheryl to come over here for the lambs. I'm going to go over to the swords for the warriors, and you stand in the middle for the watchmen. Okay. And I want us all to stand up, but when he rings the bell for each of these, or however we want to do it, I want you to actually come to the front as just a statement of faith and of receiving this word, which is from God. And Gord is a prophet of God. He has spoken to us prophetically so many times. Gord, you didn't know, we just had a prophecy of a warship, us being a warship.
Really?
Yeah, and in the back, I have another prophecy of
that wasn't me, I just
of
got
a
here
cruise
today.
Ship, of a cruise ship. No, but I'm going to give you my cruise ship prophecy. We just had that of a warship, and we have had from Sadhu Selvaraj and from Ian Clayton and just recently from Liz Wright prophecies about the mantle of Moses, this church carrying the mantle of Moses.
Ooh.
So you did pretty good, Gord.
Yeah. All right, so there's going to, again, I can't explain it, but there's going to be an impartation, okay? And so everybody just raise up your hands if you feel comfortable with that, like this, just to receive with open arms whatever he has for us. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. So, Holy Spirit, we call the lambs. We call the warriors. We call the watchmen in Jesus' name. Come!
Father, we thank you for your anointing. Lord Jesus, it breaks the yoke. We thank you, O God, that you are the great Lion of Judah. We thank you, Lord, that you are the warrior. Our God is a mighty warrior. And Lord Jesus, as we have come forward to answer this call, we know that it's not by human might or power, but by your anointing, that every war is won, that every enemy is vanquished. And Lord, we open our hearts to the anointing of the warrior of the warrior anointing of Christ. Christ, the conquering king. Christ, the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Christ, who conquered sin and death. Lord, let the anointing of the warrior come on us. We receive it in Jesus' name, that it will not be by human might or power, but by your spirit. oh God, that we destroy every work of the devil in Jesus' name. Amen.
Intercessors, you guys are right here. I didn't hear you. Oh, the watchman. Okay. Okay, watchman. I'm going to pray for watchman. Okay. Yeah, good. Okay. So remember, pray for those ones that you know that are lambs or warriors. They need your prayer support. You may be of another group, but God loves all of us. So in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord, we come tonight and we say, have your way. Lord, I pray that you would continue to clad us with that spiritual armor. Because our battle is not against flesh and blood, but it's against those spiritual principalities in high places. And so, Lord, I pray for the armor to be put on each man and woman that is here in Jesus' name. Lord, let them put it back on if they have got tired and they dropped it. Lord, let them pick it up. Let them pick up the sword of the Spirit in Jesus' name. Lord, I'm asking that you would give them strength. Lord, I pray for a new revelation of eyes to be opened up. Father, for their ears to be opened up. Lord, that you would give them eyes to see in the distance and they would give the warning of what is coming so that we as the body of Christ can prepare, that we would not get caught sleeping. Lord, we just speak that these men and women, these men and women of Issachar would sound the alarm, sound the bell. And Lord, that the body would be there and we would be ready, willing and able. So Lord, release that anointing in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Lord.
And Jesus, we thank you for all that you're doing. Father, we adore you, and Holy Spirit, we welcome you, and we say release the hosts of heaven over this region. Release the hosts of heaven. God, we thank you for the spirit of compassion. We thank you for the anointing of love, and we just say, God, release an anointing of love. Let our hearts be one with yours. Let our love be like your love. God, let us lay down our lives for the sake of our brothers. God, let us become one with you. God, we pray for a union with between heaven and earth that would release all that you are and all that you desire. Jesus, our hearts are fully yours. We just say, let us go wherever you lead. We want to be lambs that are led so easily by you that we quickly run wherever you want to go, Jesus. Jesus, we say we want to carry your heart. We want to carry the love of heaven to this earth. And we just say, Jesus, have your way and have your will. Let this be a company of people that carry your heart at the deepest level. Jesus, we thank you that you said that we could be just like you, that you would raise up a people that would be healed, body, soul, and spirit. And we call that out. And we say, we want nothing more than to lay down our will for yours. We say, your kingdom come, your will be done. Let it be on earth just like it is in heaven. Let there be a destroying of every work of the enemy, just like Jesus destroyed the work of the enemy in that day. We say we take on the call that you gave. You said it's your turn now, and we say yes to the call of God. Yes to be just like you. Yes to lay down our will for your will. And we just say yes. We want to carry compassion. We want to carry love, and we care nothing about anything other than what's on your heart. So yes, Jesus, have your way. Let your people fully, fully yield to you. We say yes to the abiding presence. Yes to the all of the Father. Yes to all that you say in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Okay, we're not quite done yet. It's going to be an all-day Saturday. Just everybody kind of take your place. And we're going to do a ministry time at the end of what I have to say. I'll keep it short, I hope. But bless you guys.
And we need to learn to encourage each other. We need to learn to encourage each other in the things that God is doing in the house. One of the things that we have been asking the Lord to bring to the area that Jan and I are ministering is unity. We're asking for unity. And unity is hard to find. Hard to find. But it's coming. Do you know that Jesus wants you to do something for the kingdom that no one else can do as well as you can do it? And the enemy knows this, and that's why he brings rejection. That's why he brings disappointments, because he's trying to shut you down. But you have way more under the hood than you realize. And a lot of Christians are running on 2 cylinders, and we should be running on 12. And so that's what the Lord wants to do. He wants us to get out on the playing field, no on the bench. The only ones on the bench is the ones that come in to give the team respite. We back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. It's like the British blockade type. You might not know what that is, but anyway, it's a warfare strategy which is very powerful. No one left sitting on the bench. Because right now we're at the appointed time. And I want to talk to you about the appointed time a little bit. In Psalm 102, verse 12 and 13, "But you, O Lord, abide forever, and your name to all generations. You will arise and have compassion on Zion, for it is time to be gracious to her, for the appointed time has come." If you've had your eyes open, we're at an appointed time. And for many Christians, they've been disappointed by God because they may not have understood this whole premise of appointed time. God has not forgotten you. He works on this principle of appointed times. And I'm sure there's many examples and testimonies that you could give of that. But all through scriptures, we see it. Now, the Bible also refers to the suddenlies, the suddenlies of God. Get ready for those, because the appointed times and the suddenlies are like cousins. They operate usually together, and it's not uncommon for you to go, "Woo, that's the appointed time for you." So watch for the suddenlies, especially starting January. Now, when it comes that fast, for you it's in a suddenly, but what happens is you're almost overnight called to an assignment. There's a calling on each of your lives, and you will receive that calling. And usually it goes like this, 1, 2, 3, 4. In other words, God will give you a calling, but he will give you assignments, one after another. But all the assignments have that same flavor of the calling. And I won't go into that tonight, but I've started many, many years ago with a calling, but I can tell you if I've had about 15 seasons. And I want to tell you this, which is getting off a little bit. Nothing happens in your life until you drop your net on the other side of the boat. You get it? Without that faith to take the risk, not foolishly, but under prayer and guidance and mentorship, whatever it takes, when you drop your nets, suddenly the impossible becomes possible. And once you have experienced the impossible, the possible is boring. We were designed for the impossible. But you need to drop your nets. I resigned at 62. I was part of the furniture, Jan and I, part of the founding couples. They looked at me, are you nuts? 62, you're part of the furniture. You could be here till you die if you want. You're crazy. And I said, I know, but I hear the Lord. So I had to drop the net on the other side. Now, here's one thing. If you're married, never do that until your spouse agrees. It just saves a lot of hassle. And so when I said to Jan, we're moving into another assignment, she was like totally there. She says, yes, do it. Let's do it. And so God has been so faithful in the last. We went from the church into itinerant ministry all over the world, and God has been faithful. He's been faithful. In Luke 24, while they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. That was a suddenly. Dave has a story. Where's a suddenly? There's an angel looking for horses.
How about these two?
I mean, these are suddenlies, but there's appointed times. And for David, what happened was that appointed time gave him such faith that you go for 10, 15 years just on that. So don't forget to drop your nets. And you got to remember this. See, Jesus is a fisherman of men, knew nothing about fishing. Here's the guys. They've got all their money in the fishing boats, in the nets, in the sails, everything. They know every square inch of the water. They know where the shoals are. They know where the weed banks are. They know where the rock. They know it all. They're professionals. And Jesus said, hi, how's it going, boys? And they go, well, not so good. What does he say? You know what they're probably thinking? What does this guy think he's doing? What does he know about fishing? We're professionals. Sometimes somebody will come up to you and you'll think, what do they know? They know nothing. And they may have a prophetic word for you that will initiate you dropping your net on the other side. I could go forever on that one thing, but just drop that on there. Acts 2. Suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house while they were sitting. You all know about that, Acts 2. That was something that happened at our church. Holy Spirit came. Boom! The only thing wasn't that we didn't have fire in our heads. But everything else happened for 5 hours. Never changed. Never changed. He was with us. He came and he stayed. Here it is, you guys. Anybody struggling? Jesus said this, I will never forsake you and I'll never leave you. And he is not a liar. He promised. The only one that screws up is us. And even when we do, he'll still chase after us and run us down and say, come on back. And so in Acts 8:39, then they came up out of the water. The Spirit of the Lord suddenly took Philip away, and the eunuch did not see him again. But he went on his way rejoicing. Signs and wonders. You guys, don't be surprised. I might not be here tomorrow. Enoch. That'd be okay. We're not going to, I could take my wife. Don't forget, and maybe read it tomorrow sometime, but the story of Joseph. Such a beautiful story. You probably heard it many times, and I'm not going to do it tonight. But his journey was preparation for his destiny. And he had appointed times, one after the other, one after the other. And by the way, it doesn't mean it's easy. Following that adventure, following that journey of the appointed time, it's not that easy. But God will always be with you. He'll give you the strength. So in spite of all of the trouble that we see in the globe, we see the turmoil, there still remains one last great outpouring of mercy before the end of the age, and we're getting close. And for many, this will be the appointed time for your destiny. Now that's another whole topic, but I'll just leave that one with you. So the saints, many have been in the background for years, and they will suddenly come forward with such a purpose and an anointing for the kingdom of God. Don't be surprised, because God usually uses the unusual circumstance, unusual people. And in the old days, we would just look at a person, judge them, and say, no. You wait and see what he's going to use. As these prodigals come in, and this wave is just beginning, they're going to freak you out. Jan's brother, I won't go into all that tonight, but they get these emails from him, and it's like, are you kidding me? I mean, he has such spiritual insight, and he's only been saved for 6-7 months. And he's so desperate for God, I don't know if you said this, he goes to the woman's Bible study. He just is hungry and he's lapping it up like a sponge. And this is what you're going to see here. So don't write anybody off. And it says in Matthew 24, and this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. So the supernatural season that is coming is not something you have to beg for. It is just going to be there because it's the appointed time of God. You can call for it, you can cry out for it, but you can't make it happen. He has already foreordained exactly the time. That's why we need the watchmen that are watching. So he's gone ahead to prepare a place for you. Now, you know the scripture in John 14 talks about the Father's house with many rooms. And he says, I'm going to, if it wasn't so, I wouldn't have told you this, and I'm going to prepare a place for you. Okay, that's great when we get there. But in the meantime, guess what? He has made a place for you now. He's not holding the carrot out and say, maybe someday. No, the appointed time, he's written down way before it happens. So for him, it's not a suddenly. It's an appointed time that he already figured out for you. And so when it comes, you just embrace it. So he's preparing the place, not only for the future, but for now. The appointed time, it is actually an open display of the majesty and the sovereignty and the power of God. It's a calling for a person. It's a group. It's a church gathering, a specific ministry, even the calling of a nation. You're going to start to see the nations, the goats and the sheep. That's another whole topic. But for GT Church, that's what I felt from the Lord, that what's been going on for 35 plus years, you've had lots of breakthroughs, but I believe that you are entering, I think I already said this, this powerful anointed time starting in January 2023. And you are going to see the impossible possible. And somebody in the house is going to have a diary or a journal, because the testimonies are going to be coming in. And every time one comes in, you say, thank you, Jesus, glory to you. Come, Holy Spirit. And maybe some of the Sundays are only going to be no preaching, no teaching. It's going to be testimonies of the body of Christ that got hammered by Holy Spirit. So at the appointed time are seasons when God fulfills the hopes and the dreams of his people. And that's what he's into. There was a song I was going to sing. I'm not going to sing it right now, but because I can't sing. But you know the Goodness of God song. Everybody knows it. And you know, like I said before, our last 5 years have been from hell. But Gord, you always play that song. I had it here and it says, because your goodness is running after me. Your goodness is running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything because your goodness is running after me. You just can't outrun his goodness. Even when it's a crappy year. He's just good all the time. So in the West, we really need this anointing because, you know, there was a time where it was God, the people, and government. I don't know about USA. I've heard rumors. But now, in Canada, it's government, people, and God's been tossed out. Out of the church, out of the schools, out of the politics. It's a bad deal. And again, it's only 2 Chronicles 7:14 that can change it. So during the appointed time, the Lord is physically going to raise up and move in unfailing compassion. And for the lovers, for those ones that are the lambs, you watch and see the kind of grace he's going to give you, because you're going to need it for impossible situations. So we need to be praying for the appointed time in the USA and in Canada, because we need the suddenly of repentance and revival. You see, you can fake repentance, but I'll tell you what, when Holy Spirit invaded our house at a Christmas party in 1986, the very first time I felt the fear of the Lord. And when he came, there was, 14 of us in the room. We all hit the floor all at the same time. We didn't go down there because we wanted to. We got knocked to the floor at the same time. Our carpet was full of snot because of weeping and crying out to God and repenting. And one of the gals, Stacy, she just got hit like this. And she starts manifesting and shaking her arms and her head and her, it was like scary. And she went down and she started to prophesy over each person like this, naming their sins. I'm over here. And she's coming in my direction. And the fear of God, I repented for everything I could think of. With fear and trembling. And when she got to me, I'd missed a couple of things. Wow. But in that appointed time, there was divine promises and spiritual hopes that were fulfilled, because we were hungry. And we didn't know what it looked like, but we were hungry. And God will honor your hunger. So you guys know the stories, and I'll land the plane real quick. Abraham and Sarah, they waited 25 years for the promise. You know that story. And 1 year later, after the promise, at the appointed time, Isaac was born. This is how God works. You know, either we get way ahead of him or way behind. We have to understand the appointed time and ask for patience. And we make all these plans. You know, Psalms 2 talks about all the plans. And he who sits in heaven laughs. Don't put him in a box. Nice try, guys, but I'm going to do this. Boom! And you get the suddenly. You get the suddenly. All right, I'm just going to move on. If God gave you a vision, a hope, a dream, a promise for your future, there will be an appointed time when that which God spoke comes to pass. Do not let the enemy steal the promises. If you've received a prophetic word, and it was confirmed that that is a prophetic word, and it hasn't come to pass at this point, don't give up. Like Jan said, never give up. You hold on to the promises of God. And then you may be hidden for years, months, and then suddenly comes your appointed time. And you go, okay, God, I'm ready. I'm going to go for it. He planned it a long time ago. For you, it's a suddenly, but it's an appointed time. Record the vision and inscribe it on tables, that the one who reads it may run with it. For the vision is yet for the appointed time. It runs towards the goal and it will not fail. Though it tarries, wait for it, for it will certainly come. It will not delay. See, you think it's delayed, maybe, in your case. It's not delayed. You got the wrong clock. It's God's clock. So though your vision may not come to pass yet, you want to wait for it. We know that the 12 disciples, they were appointed servants of God. And they think that they chose God. No. God chose them. And I'd always say that you and I, as human beings, we probably wouldn't have picked that bunch. But God did. because he knows what he's doing in the mystery of God. So he chose us. He chose us. How does that make you feel? If you don't believe this, get that way. He chose you. Praise be to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us to be adopted as his sons through Christ Jesus, in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one that he loves. You see, Jesus doesn't drop the promise. We're the issue. We are disappointed at times. We are disobedient. We get ahead of God. You know, you heard of backsliders? Well, there's a lot of Christians that are forward sliders. Do you know what a forward slider is? Get ahead of God. In the zeal, they get a whole head of Holy Spirit. And they crash land. It's a disaster. They get disappointed because they went a hold of... That's why we need team. That's why we need unity. That's why we work together so that we can sustain the glory. So Jesus chose us and he's appointed us to bear fruit. Now, hope deferred makes the heart grow sick. I understand that. But a longing fulfilled is a tree of life. As God drops these appointed times on you, you are going to feel this sense of refreshing, of being fulfilled, and just don't be disappointed when you see somebody else moving into their appointed time. You need to celebrate that they're moved into that place. Disappointment is just a sad emotion of the mind, and deep disappointment can actually separate your heart from your faith. So you can't let that disappointment stay on you. You need someone to pray for you. You need Holy Spirit to remove that. That disappointment thing can become demonic, and it can hold you tight away from what God's called you to. So, lots to say. I'm going to stop. I want to pray. Some of you guys have been disappointed. I'm not going to ask you to stand because I don't want to embarrass you. But I want to pray over you that God, by Holy Spirit, will crush that disappointment. And that you can move in even optimism, even if it's cautious optimism. That you can move in the direction and say, okay, Jesus, I'm here, help me. And we need to get people to pray for us. And we can move into the appointed time. So disappointments, now some of you are disappointed in God. I understand that. But the reason you're disappointed is because your timing is not the same as his. And he loves you. He so loves you. And even in your deepest hour, he'd be there for you. Let go and let God. Right? We want the joy of the Lord. That's what we want. Not fake joy. Joy of the Lord. And the joy of the Lord is our strength. So we don't want to be men and women walking around like we got dipped in a big bottle of lemon oil. We want to have a smile. Not a fake smile, but the reassurance inside of us that he will come with a suddenly. And if you've experienced a suddenly, say, Jesus, thank you for that suddenly. And if you're still waiting, just give him some time. So let me just pray. Everybody stand up, please, if you can stand up. Thank you, Jesus. Disappointments can be like getting stung by a huge bee. We can get almost like a reaction to that thing, like an allergy reaction. And it can almost imprison us It freezes our spirit. It freezes a lot of things. So in the name of Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit, I just invite you right now. If you feel comfortable, just put your hands out in front of you like I have right now. Some of you are going to feel the glory of God on your hands. Just wait for a bit. And the way that it feels, it could be tingling or it just could be weight. You're going to feel the weight of the glory, the kavod. You may feel it on your shoulders. When you wait, you will feel the weight. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Release, release, release. Lord, release your glory. Release the weight. Jesus, we look forward to signs and wonders and miracles and healings and deliverance and even raising the dead. Lord, we look forward to doing the things that you've called us to do in the name of Jesus. Releasing that impartation, releasing, 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 releasing the weight. Release the weight. Thank you, Jesus. In the name of Jesus, we break disappointment off your spirit, off your mind, and off your heart, in Jesus' name. Go, in Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Some of you, when you go home tonight, you're going to be in bed. You're going to feel the weight of Holy Spirit on you. It's just a phenomenal thing that he does. It's a beautiful thing that he does. Lord, I pray for many that need it tonight when they get home, Lord, that the disappointment would run off of them like water off a duck's back. Lord, that you'd go deep into their spirit, into their heart. Lord, would you just release it, your grace and your mercy tonight. The ones that need that, Lord, just do it in Jesus' name for your glory. And Lord, I pray that you'd give many in the room patience to wait with a smile on their face, knowing that you've already predestined them, that you've already got their calling in the palm of your hand. Their assignments are waiting right there. Father, I can't wait. Start now, but we just pray for the January impartation. Releasing, releasing, releasing. So, Lord, seal this prayer time by your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name. Amen.